Okay, trappers, please go ahead and find your seats. Trappers, if you're standing in the middle, I need you to go ahead and find your seat, please. There's plenty of rooms on the back. There's some right here in the front as well. Trappers, ninth graders, thank you for joining us today. Thank you. Muchísimas gracias. We're going to go ahead and start. And I'm going to turn over the time to Lizzie, Mecha, and all the wonderful students that are going to be participating in this wonderful assembly. How about if we give them, just to start, a big, warm welcome, applause for all those participants. How about that?
Okay, hello everyone. Welcome to our Women's History Month Assembly. I will be your MC today. My name is Lizzie. I am a senior here at Fort Vancouver High School and an officer for a club called Mecha. Before we get started, I know most of you are freshmen, so it might be your first time in the auditorium. Some quick etiquette is just that no food, and if you have any drink, please just have it be water. Silence your cell phones, and please keep your voices off and be respectful of our speakers today. I want to start off our assembly by acknowledging that we are on the traditional lands of the Cowlitz tribe. We, as settlers and as people who are not part of First Nations or Indigenous groups, are residing on and benefiting from their land. The Cowlitz Indian tribe are the forever people who for generations have preserved living in harmony with the lands and passing down traditions with pride. The Cowlitz people continue to remain connected to this land, and they engage in cultural practices of old Cowlitz lifeways, such as smelt, salmon, and river ceremonies. They join many coastal tribes in journeys and canoe journeys. They drum and sing and are called upon for funerals, naming ceremonies, healing, and celebration. The Cowlitz people have weathered storms with honor and unity, holding tight to their independence and culture. But this is not a simple story of yesterday. It is a celebration of tomorrow and the unwavering Cowlitz spirit. Of all they have done and will continue to do, like the songs that mark the tribe's most important moments, it is both relevant and triumphant. It is a reminder that the Cowlitz Indian tribe, the people whose land we stand, are the forever people. We never had a song for defeat. We also want to acknowledge that our nation has benefited from the free and slave labor of black people. We honor the legacy of the African diaspora and black life. We honor the knowledge, skills, and human spirit that persevere in spite of violence and white supremacy. We commit to the standing up against racism and acknowledging in all facets of our life that black lives matter. Thank you all for being here in the auditorium and for watching this assembly live. Okay, to start off this assembly, you all will be watching a music video, and I kind of wanted to provide some context for it. According to the National Institute of Statistics and Geography in Mexico, an average of 10 women are murdered every single day simply for being women. These are not just numbers. They represent the daughters, sisters, mothers, and friends who have been brutally taken away from us. Behind each statistic lies a story of pain, fear, and injustice. Femicide is a global crisis that affects women worldwide. It is a manifestation of deep-rooted gender inequality, discrimination, and violence against women. It thrives in environments where misogyny is tolerated and perpetrators are shielded from accountability. Bringing awareness to the issue of femicide in Mexico is not merely about acknowledging the problem. It is about taking a stand against gender-based violence in all forms. It is about demanding justice for the victims and holding perpetrators accountable for their heinous actions. It is about creating a society where every woman feels safe, valued, and empowered to live her best life without fear. We cannot afford to remain silent spectators in the face of such injustice. We must amplify the voices of the victims, advocate for policy reforms, and support grassroots initiatives that aim to eradicate femicide and violence against women. We must challenge the toxic masculinity that perpetrates violence and work towards building a culture of respect, equality, and empathy. As individuals, as communities, and as a society, we have the moral obligation to confront femicide head on and work tirelessly toward a future where every woman can live free from the threat of violence. Let us stand in solidarity, raise our voices for the voiceless, and strive to create a world where femicide is nothing but a dark chapter in history. I present to you a song called Canción Sin Miedo, which translates to A Song Without Fear.
Ah. estado, los cielos, las calles, que tiemblen los jueces y los judiciales. Hoy a las mujeres nos quitan la calma, nos sembraron miedo, nos crecieron alas. A cada minuto de cada semana nos roban amigas, nos matan hermanas, destrozan sus cuerpos, los desaparecen. No olvides sus nombres, por favor, señor presidente. Por todas las compas luchando en Reforma, por todas las morras peleando en Sonora, por las comandantas luchando por Chiapas, por todas las madres buscando en Tijuana. Cantamos sin miedo, pedimos justicia, gritamos por cada desaparecida. Que resuene fuerte, nos queremos vivas. Que caiga con fuerza el feminicida. Yo todo lo incendio, yo todo lo rompo. Si un día algún fulano te apaga los ojos, ya nada me calla, ya todo me sobra. Si tocan a una, respondemos todas. Soy Claudia, soy Esther y soy Teresa. Caiga con fuerza el feminicida. Y retiemble en sus centros la tierra al sonoro rugir del amor. Y retiemble.
And now please give another warm round of applause for our choir.
Good morning, everybody. So the piece that we're about to sing for you is by a gentleman named Mark Burroughs. He wrote this piece when his two teenage daughters encouraged him to join them at a rally after yet another school shooting had taken place. And he wrote this to kind of mimic the feeling of the heartbeat of the people walking at this particular march. And it's called I Am Power. And before we performed this piece, I asked the students last week to just respond to the prompt, I am, and then to fill in whatever it was they felt I am. So I took all of those responses and I put them together as a poem that I wanted to read to you before we sing for you. So this is all coming from the students in our choirs. I am tired, worried, overwhelmed. I am nauseous. I am hurt. I am hurting. I am a singer, a sibling, a survivor, a daughter, an aunt, a sister. I am independent, determined. I am the change in my own life. I am peaceful, beautiful. I am joy and hope. I am perfect just the way I am. I am a wallflower, a fire in the hearth, a thunderstorm. I am unique. I am weird. I am an artist, a believer. I am enigmatic, nonconforming. I am God's child. I am an islander. I am Hawaiian. I am mixed. I am me. I am a nice person, willing to change. I am strong enough to move on. I am proud of myself, doing the best I can. I am at peace. I am a choir kid. I am really cool. I am strong. I am me. This is I Am Power.
I am purpose.
Alrighty, if I could have everybody's attention once more, please. Big round of applause for our choir. Alrighty, so we're gonna hop right into our keynote speaker, Veronica de Jesus. Big round of applause for her, please.
This one, yeah. Hi, everyone. I am going to first say I'm so sorry. I'm fighting something, and I lost my voice. So I truly appreciate your patience and your close attention. Before I get started, I want to say a couple of words. For those of you who don't know me, I am Veronica de Jesus. I am the Family and Community Resource Coordinator for Fort Vancouver High School. I am a trapper myself, but now I have stepped into being a staff member, and it is so amazing to be able to be here as now a member of my colleagues. And yeah, so before I get started, I want to talk to you guys about a story of this little girl. This little girl was me at one point. I was brought here to the United States when I was 4 years old. My parents had a dream to give us an opportunity that perhaps they wouldn't have been able to give us had we stayed at our in Mexico. So my dad brought us when I was 4 years old, and I went through a lot of adversity. I remember in elementary school being told by many staff and many teachers that I was not going to amount to anything. My ability to speak English at the time was not great. And I was also a child who had a lot of energy and a lot to say. In, I wanna say, early elementary school, I was told by a teacher that I was a lost cause and a lost case, that I was always interrupting and asking too many questions. And little did I know that this piece of being so bad, right, was actually my power, was what really changed the trajectory of my future. This is what pushed me to be here today and to be able to stand here with so much pride in what I've accomplished, and also through strong faith. Faith looks different to each and every one of us, but I'm here to tell you that despite what somebody tells you and despite what you've gone through in life, you have the power to change your future. You are the one that can decide whether or not you want your future to look a certain way. It can be owning a house. It can be taking your family out of poverty. It could be whatever it is. And it sounds cliche, but truly, I think each and every one of us has a dream inside of us that we just have not let shine. And I care about each and every one of you, which is why I am here at Fort. I remember when I was told that I got the job, I was so heartbroken because I loved my previous job. But I wanted to make a change in one of your guys' future. If I could be that person to motivate you in one way or another, so be it. And I am here to stand and say that I am so proud that each and every one of you has something to say. You all have a beautiful story to tell. And I hope that one day, again, it sounds cliche, but you let that little dream continue to spark and you fire that thing up. If I can be of any help to any of you, please, please feel free to come in and say hi or whatever. Thank you so very much. I want to make sure that I'm okay on time. And one last thing is that I know that I don't know what your future looks like. I know that I also don't know what your past may have been. I also don't know what your, you know, what the future circumstances can come to you, but when you let your mind be the one to motivate you, when you keep control of your mind, you are able to accomplish and do so much amazing things. Again, thank you so very much for this time. I appreciate your kindness in accepting my voice the way it is right now. So bless you all in so many ways, and thank you so very much for this time.
Let's give a big round of applause to our panelists for today.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. I'm Ms. Rivard. I teach English and theater, and I'm an advisor for MECHA, along with my wonderful coworker and co-advisor. I will let her introduce herself.
Hi, I'm Peroni. I advise MECHA with Rivard, and I teach English.
Hi, my name is Jessica. I'm a senior, and I am a MECHA officer and Key Club president. As part of that, I've hosted two assemblies, hosted our Day of the Dead dance, and also planned community service events and raised money to help end youth houselessness.
I'm Athena, and I'm a senior. I've been involved in three sports and ASB all 4 years. In ASB, I've had the privilege of having experience as the ASB secretary and president. I have also been in NHS for 2 years.
And then I'm Maddie. I'm a senior. I am the ASB vice president.
My name's Relisha, I'm a sophomore. I'm the BSU co-president, a three-sport athlete, an ASB officer, a student ambassador, I'm in student advisory, and I'm the sophomore class president.
My name is April, I am a senior. I've been a varsity basketball captain here at Fort for 3 years. I am also part of ASB and student ambassador.
So obviously, a lot of leadership on this stage, and thank you so much, freshmen, for being so respectful while our student leaders are up here. We really appreciate it. You get a bad rap, right? So let's show Fort how respectful that freshman can be. You want to start us off, Peroni?
All right, so we just had introductions, and the first thing I want to ask is, in your leadership roles, what projects have you been involved in that have allowed you to showcase those skills, those leadership skills?
In student ambassador, we planned assemblies. As a captain, I make sure that the team is all together and on the same page.
I'm also a student ambassador, and we did a lot of assemblies, as well as being an ASB, do a lot of assemblies. But for BSU, we've planned some events this year, and yeah. Oh, and I've done dances for ASB.
So in ASB, I have planned a couple of fundraisers and also school events. It has taught me organizational skills, delegation skills, and just leadership.
So just to add on about ASB, I feel like, first of all, join ASB. But secondly, you learn a lot about public speaking. If you look at the panelists today, we have four people who have been in ASB. And I feel like our public speaking skills, planning an organization, and also, just the, having the opportunity to plan school-wide events has been very beneficial to us as young women and as workers in society.
For me, as MECHA officer, we helped put on today's assembly as well as the Hispanic Heritage Month assembly. We put on our Day of the Dead dance, and also for Key Club, a lot of community service events around our community, such as marathons and a lot of raising money.
All right, so we have a couple questions. We're gonna go around and get some answers from our wonderful young women leaders here. The next question is, what support systems or mentorship opportunities have been instrumental in helping you navigate the challenges of being a young girl in leadership? So who are those people that were there for you that helped show you the way? And let's start with Maddie on this one.
Well, I would say just peers in ASB, somebody to work with and just help you through it all. And then also teachers like Turcotte and Jados, who you could just vent to and be have an outside perspective.
All right, thank you. Let's go to Felicia next.
I'd say coaches, being an athlete, you always go to your coaches for advice and stuff, but also the other girls like Athena and April and all the basketball girls have all helped me, whether it's basketball or having confidence in being a leader. And so, yeah, just the people around you.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Let's pass it over to April, one of your mentors.
Here at Four is coaches. They have been a really big part of my family. They taught me how to be a great captain and a leader. Also, Ms. Peroni, she taught me how to be a good person, how to manage stress. With that, her teaching me how to be a good leader. Also, my stepdad, because he taught me how to be a good leader in every possible way. He made me who I am today.
Thank you so much. Let's finish it off with Athena.
So I would definitely say that one of my biggest prides in being a Fort Vancouver student is our community. And I would say as a young woman and a leader, as well as an athlete, I find that my peers around me, as well as coaches and adults, have been the biggest supporters. Shout out to our Lisa. Yep. Because everybody here has been impacted by at least one of your staff members in your life. And I would definitely say for a lot of us, a big one is definitely our Lisa, as well as Rivard. And I think that has been, okay, and Griff. That has been the biggest support system for me here.
Thank you so much. All right, next question.
Okay, so now that we've heard about some of these amazing things that you've done as leaders, I want to ask, have you encountered any challenges or gender biases as young women aspiring to be leaders? And yeah, let's talk about that. So let's start with Athena on this one.
So I would say that as a young girl, a lot of the times I was told that I was loud because I was outspoken. I was told I was bossy because I was very determined to be a leader. And I was told I was sassy because I was very straightforward. I do believe that through pushing through the criticism and finding acceptance with myself, that I was able to overcome that and use all of those criticisms as a way to better build myself.
All right, let's go to Jessica next.
Definitely relatable. I feel like coming into these leadership roles, rather than taken seriously and being seen as assertive or a powerful leader, you end up being viewed as bossy or overly strict. And for me, it was just really hard to overcome that. But I had to recognize that, I mean, I was being the best leader that I could be, and I just had to try my best to stay sophisticated and composed to prove that I was what I could be.
Absolutely. Let's finish up this question with April.
In my experience as a leader, people say I'm a very aggressive person and think that is an excuse not to listen to me. The way I communicate is just very direct. Nothing personal to the people that obviously. But I'm a very respectful person, but that doesn't mean that I have to be sweet to everybody to be a good leader.
All right, thanks so much.
I saw our Lisa nodding her head back there. All right, next question. In what ways do you think being a young woman in leadership positions can challenge those power dynamics? And how can our schools and our school systems better support you all and other young girls to become future leaders? This is a big loaded question, but I think let's start with our youngest leader on the panel. Let's start with Relisha.
I think women being women in leadership challenges the power dynamics just itself. Like, people always think It's the women, you know, the women lead. And I feel like especially at our school, we have a lot of women representation in leadership. And I think that's very important. But if we're talking about like outside of our school, I think that people should just give women more opportunity to be leaders that they know they can be and encourage women, because I feel like we have a lot of that in our school, and for that I'm very appreciative, because I mean, look at us, like, yeah.
Wonderful, that's a great answer. Let's go over to Maddie, since you have the mic.
Well, I would say being a big part of being a leader is delegating jobs for women that could often be seen as bossy, whereas a man doing the same thing could be seen as a good leader and have good delegation skills. And I think by highlighting and encouraging women to join all women support groups or just clubs in general, it just makes you see how much women could have and can do in these leadership positions. And so it just breaks down those power norms.
Great. And we're going to end it with Relisha, this question. Wait, no, we're going to end it with Jessica.
Okay, so for me, it's always that it's being a young woman in leadership definitely challenges those stereotypical gender norms, but it helps bring in like fresh perspectives, and it really provides support for young women by encouraging participation in leadership roles. And I think you just have to face those fears and kind of not be afraid to challenge what's stereotypical.
Wonderful, thank you so much. And all of you that have little siblings and maybe little sisters, you can encourage them to become leaders too, which kind of brings us to our last question that Peroni will wrap up our student panel with.
Okay, so the last question is, what advice would you give to other young women who aspire to take on leadership roles? And we're gonna have all of you answer.
The best advice I could give is that even if you're uncertain of whether or not you want to go into a leadership position, is to just do it anyways. Don't be afraid to ask questions to those that came before you, and just always make sure that you remain true to yourself. Don't feel the pressure of people. Don't listen to what things people may say, and just remain true to what you think is the right thing.
I would say that my biggest advice is definitely to be true to yourself and to embrace your strengths. I think that poise, grace are very much expected of young women in society today, but I also think that it is so important to let your inner child shine, because you're gonna have to be an adult real soon.
My advice would be that you are welcomed and so supported here when finding how you could be a leader.
My advice is to be kind to everybody, because that's just a way to have everybody, you know, like, if you're kind to somebody, they're going to be kind back to you. But also, like, a common theme here, don't let people tell you what you can and can't do, because they're not you, and you can make decisions for yourself, and you're strong, and yeah.
My advice is take accountability of your actions, speak your mind, and stay true to yourself. I have a quote of the day, the only limits that exist are the ones you place on yourself.
So I just want to thank these young women in leadership up here that represent a lot of different kinds of leadership, a lot of different backgrounds, and have all made a huge positive contribution at Ford. And I want to encourage all of you to follow in their footsteps and find some place to lead. And like April said, what was your quote of the day again?
The only limits that exist are the only ones you place on yourself.
Right, the only limits that you place are the ones you place on yourself. So don't place any limits on yourself. And let's give the student panel a big, big round of applause. Stage people.
It's going down?
Alrighty, so if I could have everybody's attention for the last bit of this assembly. Today, we're going to gather to celebrate a truly remarkable individual. This teacher exemplifies the spirit of Women's History Month through her tireless efforts to empower and inspire generations of students. For Miss A, teaching isn't just a profession, it's a calling. A calling she has answered with grace, wisdom, and boundless love. Over the years, she has not only imparted knowledge, but also instilled values, nurtured dreams, and ignited passions. She has been a guiding light, a mentor, and a source of strength for so many who have walked through these very same halls. But her impact extends far beyond the classroom. Through her kindness, compassion, and dedication to excellence, she has left an unforgettable mark on our school community and beyond. Some messages from her students include, Miss A is a one of a kind and played a huge role in my success at Fort. Is from a former student, from a former colleague, she's an inspiration as an educator and as an activist for human rights, especially those in the Latinx community. Because of you, I developed curiosity for accents, Latin American cultures, and a deep love for my own. I hope you know that you have an entire generation that loves you and wants the absolute best for you. Thank you. From a former student, you are irrevocably a part of the souls of every student who has had the pleasure of being in your class. When I am teaching my own students, I think of you and how you had the ability to really see your students, to care about their stories and offer your own. I think about how your classroom was warm and light and home. Miss A has shown us the power of education to transform lives and shape futures. Let us not only celebrate Miss A for her extraordinary achievements, but also take this opportunity to honor the countless women who have made and continue to make a difference in our lives and in the world. Miss A, thank you for your dedication, your passion, and your unwavering commitment to excellence. You have truly changed lives, and your legacy will continue to inspire generations to come. A huge round of applause to you and to all the women who have helped shape our past, present, and future.
We love Mrs. A. And I want to just give a huge shout out to our Mecha leadership, Laura, Jessica, Evelyn, and huge round of applause for Lizzie, our MC. This young leader is so organized, so on top of it, took the initiative for this particular assembly, and I just cannot wait to see some of y'all run for president in 2044, I think, is when you're eligible. So let's see a woman on the ticket then, or hopefully before then, but at least then.
And then I'll give you a shout out. Ms. Rivard, I believe that so many students can agree, has made a huge impact on us, and I think you're the Miss A of our generation. Huge round of applause to her. Alrighty, so I want to go ahead and end off this assembly today. I want to take a moment to say a few things. To all the young girls here today, I urge you to embrace your potential as future leaders. The world needs your voice, your ideas, and your unique perspectives now more than ever. As you navigate your journey into womanhood, remember these three key pieces of advice. Firstly, believe in yourself. You are capable of achieving greatness beyond your wildest dreams. Don't let doubt or fear hold you back. Trust in your abilities and pursue your passions with unwavering determination. Secondly, never underestimate the power of education. Knowledge is the foundation upon which you will build your future. Education is not just about acquiring facts. It is about developing critical thinking skills, empathy, and resilience. Lastly, lift each other up. As you strive for success, remember to support and uplift your fellow sisters. Collaboration, not competition, is the key to progress. So, as you leave here today, carry these words with you. Embrace your potential, pursue knowledge relentlessly, and lift others as you rise. The future belongs to you, and I have no doubt that you will lead with grace, courage, and compassion. Thank you all for being part of this incredible event. Let's go forth and change the world. Thank you.
Okay, Trappers, we are going to go to third period, okay? We're going to go to third period. Again, Trappers, thank you and enjoy the rest of your day.
Then get back to business.